Good morning. Good morning. Thanks, Jenny, for that. That's nice prelude. It looks like everybody made it here. It looks like everybody had plenty of sleep. That's good. This is the one day of the year that we should have plenty of sleep. I'd like to welcome everyone to our worship service this morning. My name is Will Schwarzendruber. We're glad you're here, and we hope that this morning's worship service will be a blessing to both you and to our Lord. When I saw that the topic for today's sermon was about wisdom and justice, I immediately had to think of the book of Proverbs in the Bible. Proverbs is filled with many wise sayings dealing with human life. In fact, the writers have left no area untouched. I also had to think of one of our famous founding fathers, and the resident of Pennsylvania where I grew up. Of course, I'm referring to Ben Franklin. Here are some of my famous quotes of Ben's. Life's tragedy is that we get old too soon and wise too late. The doors of wisdom are never shut. An investment in knowledge pays the best interest. It is better to remain silent at the risk of being thought a fool than to talk and remove all doubt. Many people die at 25 and aren't buried until they're 75. Here's one to probably want to use. When you are testing to see how deep the water is, never use 2 feet. Keep your eyes wide open before marriage and half shut afterwards. This is Scott's favorite. 3 may keep a secret if 2 of them are dead. Justice will not be served until those who are unaffected are as outraged as those who are. And injustice anywhere is the threat to justice everywhere. And that one was not Ben Franklin's, that was Martin Luther King Jr.'s. Here are a few from the book of Proverbs that speak of wisdom and justice. This comes from Proverbs 3, 5 to 7. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. In all ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. That sounds like a song. Proverbs 9:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. And Proverbs 16:8. Better is a little with righteousness than a large income with injustice. And this last verse comes from Amos 5:24. Martin Luther King Jr. used this verse in his famous I Have a Dream speech, which he gave on the steps in front of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. in 1963, when he was speaking out against racial injustice. And this is from Amos 5:24. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Let's continue our worship as Zach comes and leads us in some songs.
First two songs. First one is Better Is One Day. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even to you.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere.
All right, and for this next song, it's kind of a repeating one. I'm going to be singing the first part, and you are more than welcome to do that. Hadley is going to be singing the second part in the parentheses, so you can follow her if you'd rather sing that part. Your choice.
I will worship.
Good morning. It's part of our worship service where we can share any prayer concerns we might have, any praises, or any announcements. Scott has the mic. If anybody has anything to share?
I'd just like to inform you about people I know. In the sower, the prayer request is for Jacob Guckenberger, I guess, pastor of Christ Community Church, and he's being ordained. His wife is already the pastor there, so they're going to be pastoring that church together. And Christ Community Church is the church that joined our conference in about 15 or so years ago because they liked the Anabaptist theology. And they actually meet in a Jewish synagogue. They share the facility with the Jewish congregations, which because they worship on Saturday or Friday night, and so then it's available Sunday morning. And so anyway, that just gives you a little information about who we're praying for there.
Okay. Thanks, Don.
My name is Sarah Schlegel, and over the past several months, I have been organizing worship leaders, and one of the things that we have had happen is several children have been the worship leader with their parents. And it's a little tricky for them to get to the microphone. And so I'm going to ask Randy to do me a favor and pull out a bench. I asked Leroy Garman if he would make a bench that now lives underneath our pulpit so that when children are worship leaders, they can easily pull it out and stand up so we can all hear them. And for all the children that have done it, thank you for saying yes, and I will continue to be calling you guys.
To kind of go with that, Jolynn and I have been talking the last couple of weeks of getting together more people to do praise and worship stuff and fairly more often. If that's something that you would be interested in, to play or sing anything, please talk to one of us and we'll get something set up.
A couple things that are happening today. First of all, right after worship, there's going to be a meeting in the fellowship hall for anybody that's interested in becoming a member here at Salem. It'll be a short meeting just to kind of go over what that process is and see if you have any questions about what it means to be a member here. So that will be right after worship in the fellowship hall. And at 2 o'clock today, also in the fellowship hall, is a meeting for anyone considering baptism. So any, especially kids, but anybody that's thinking about that would invite you to come hear about that. That will probably be about an hour long, and there will be some time for discussion with kids and parents, and so make sure you bring mom or dad or grandma or grandpa along with you as part of that. Also, just want to call your attention to the meeting on November 20th. On that day, we will have worship at 9:30, and then a meeting at 10:30 here in the Fellowship Hall, and that is, again, in regards to our relationship with Mennonite Church USA and Central Plains. If you have any questions you would like to ask at that meeting, you can submit written questions, and we may also take some time for just off-the-cuff questions. But if you have anything you know you want to ask, it would be great to have that ahead of time. That's mostly informational. There will be a time for small group discussion sometime after the start of the new year. So we will have that as well. Thank you.
I know we've all been praying for Jen and Carl, and they much appreciate that. Carl got to come home, and it's not going really great for them. Jen is really, really struggling, so we could really use some mighty prayers for them and some decisions that might need to be made. And just so that Carl's healing, we could still pray for his health, but Jen needs some major prayers from us.
Good morning. Okay, it's about that time of year. Christmas program for the kids is going to be December 18th. It's going to be during the sermon. So if you guys could have your kids here by 9 o'clock every Sunday, we're going to do half an hour practices before Sunday school. And then on the 11th, we'll just do normal. We'll do all Sundays through Sunday school. So teachers, don't worry about that Sunday or the 18th. So yeah, if you could have your kids here by 9, that would be great and wonderful. Christmas decor, for if anybody wants to help, we're going to do something cool. We haven't done this in a while. But next Wednesday, the 16th, not this coming Wednesday, but the 16th, we're all going to meet at the church at 5:30. The kids will go down about 6 o'clock or about 5:30 to do the 707. Is that right? Am I right on that? Okay. And then we're going to do a potluck. So if anybody wants to bring a casserole dish and kind of hang out and socialize, we haven't done one of those for a really long time, and then decorate after that, that would be really great. I think it would be fun. So that's going to be the 16th. And then I'll put those both of those in the bulletin as well for the next coming Sundays and stuff. But also wanted to give an update on Aaron. He has started his process coming home. Yay. he is in Kuwait right now, and he'll be there probably for a good another week or so. And then he has to be in Fort Hood for a little while. So we're thinking that he's probably going to come home the week of Thanksgiving, and if not, maybe Thanksgiving Day. So hopefully everything's fine, but prayers for him to come home safely would be great. So thank you.
I I'm just going to invite you all to pancakes and coffee Saturday morning from 8 until 10 at the community center, and the free will donation goes towards our Passing the Bread Basket mission.
Scott.
I just want to highlight here in the bulletin about NCC Meat Canner at Milford this Thursday. We will probably go up after school on Thursday, and if you're interested, we usually get home somewhere between 9 and 10. If you're interested, I'd say either contact me or Ben.
Okay. If no one else has anything to share, join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful fall morning. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to gather together for worship. Be with us today through the Holy Spirit and meet each one of us where we are at today, and help us to grow in our understanding of you and in our relationship with you. Lord, thank you for the offerings that were collected today. Bless them and help them to further your kingdom wherever they are used, and bless each person who gave so generously. We are thankful for the people who are celebrating birthdays this week. Be with Wilma Lichty, Donna Salzman, Suzanne Nolt, Courtney Nolt, Hadley Schlegel, Ada Schlegel, and Isaac Janning. God, we pray a special blessing for each one as they celebrate their birthday this week. Lord God, we pray that you would be with our church as we elect a new member for our elder board. Thank you for the people who are willing to serve you in this capacity. And Lord, we pray that your will would be done during this process. We also lift up the elections for positions in our local, state, and federal government on Tuesday. Lord, I pray that anyone elected as leaders, both in our church or in public office, look to you for guidance and discernment. Help us to remember that you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we are here to serve you humbly. Lord God, continue to be with Larry Eichelberger, Donna Salzman, and Elijah Philippi. We just pray, Lord, for continued healing and peace in the situations that they're dealing with. Lord, we're thankful that Carl is home, and we just pray for continual healing, Lord. We're thankful for the healing that has taken place in his body, and we just pray for continual healing for him. And we pray for Jen, Lord, as she takes care of him and has decisions to make. We just pray for your guiding and leading for her, and just peace for both of them as they continue through this challenge. Lord, pray that you would be with the meat canning this week. Be with the group from Salem that is going to help. Grant them safety as they travel. Bless their time as they are there. Help to be a special time for them, and help them to grow closer to you as they serve in that way. Thank you, Lord, for the different talents and gifts that you provide us. Lord, thank you for Leroy and his gift of woodworking and the bench that he provided. We pray that you would bless him for doing that for us. And Lord, we pray that you would be with anyone who wants to share with our worship service through praise and worship. Help them to feel led and to help with that. Lord God, we pray for the membership meetings that are taking place after service. Just pray that you would lead anyone who feels like they would like to be a member here to go and talk with Pastor Ben and be with them through that process. Be with the baptism meetings, Lord, later on this afternoon. Lord, help those that are feeling that call to feel your presence and to feel the Holy Spirit tugging at their heart, and just be with them through that presence or through that process, and I pray that it would be a special time for them. Be with us as we meet as a congregation, Lord, on the 20th, and just pray that you would continue to be with each one of us as we pray about what we're talking about, and as we go through that process, just pray that your will would be done in our church. Lord God, we pray for Aaron Powell as he finishes up his deployment and travels home. Lord, we pray for safety, for travel mercies, and we just pray that he would make it home for that Thanksgiving holiday to be with friends and family, and just pray that he comes home safe and sound. Lord, we also pray that you would continue to be with Jacob Gutenberg as he is ordained at Christ Community Church. Lord God, be at work in him and help him to further your kingdom and do your will in his life that you have planned out for him. Lord, we pray that you would continue to be with us in our service. Be with Pastor Ben as he shares with us today, and just bless us as we worship you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
All right. If you turn with me to song number 70 in the blue book, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Our scripture this morning comes from two different places, one in the Old Testament, one in the New Testament. The first is Deuteronomy 32, 1-4, and this is in the NIV. Listen, you heavens, and I will speak. Hear, you earth, the words of my mouth. Let my teaching fall like rain, and my words descend like dew, like showers on new grass, like abundant rain on tender plants. I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Oh, praise the greatness of our God. He is the rock. His works are perfect, and all his ways are just. A faithful God who does no wrong. Upright and just is he. And then Romans 11, 33-36. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his path beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Ben?
Thank you, Will, and would you all join me in prayer? Lord, we thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you that you are on the throne, that you are overseeing all things in the universe and all things in our lives. Lord, you are on the throne, which means we, in turn, are your servants. Lord, you have saved us from our sin. You have given us a place in your family, adopted us as your children, and now you have called us to love you and serve you with all of our being. So, Lord, as we are here to worship you this morning, we bow down to you, the one who is on the throne. Lord, we ask that as we are here today, that you would give us a word that would heal us, that would encourage us, that would challenge us. Lord, we pray that you would give us the strength that we need to go from here today to apply these things to our lives, to serve you, and to share your love with the people around us. So, Lord, we ask that we would have open ears and open hearts to hear that word and apply it today. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're continuing this morning by looking at some of God's characteristics. 3 weeks ago, we looked at God's holiness and said that that basically means two things. God's holiness means that he is set apart and different from everything else in creation, and it also means that God is completely good. They're completely morally good. There's nothing wrong in God, and God cannot do wrong because he is totally morally pure. So that was holiness. 2 weeks ago, we said that God is omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent, which means he is present everywhere, he is all-knowing, and he is all-powerful, in control of everything. And then last week, we looked at God's love, and I encouraged us to not take God's love for granted. Sometimes, even when we're around amazing things, if we get used to it, it loses some of its luster, some of its specialness. God's love is so amazing. And when we've had it our whole lives, or if we've had it for 10 or 20 or 30 years, maybe sometimes we start to take it for granted. But God's love is so amazing. He loved us while we were still sinners, that we can't take that for granted. So today we're looking at God's justice and wisdom. And we're going to start with justice, and then at the end we'll pick up wisdom. How did you learn about justice? Who taught you about justice? My guess is you learned something about justice from your parents and grandparents or guardians, from teachers at school. They taught you the basics of what is right and what is wrong and how you are supposed to act. And sometimes when we're learning about justice, there's rewards for doing what's right and punishment for doing what's wrong. So I got dessert if I ate everything on my plate at supper time. And when I ate the frosting off of Grandma's cake for her 50th birthday, I got a punishment. Justice. Right and wrong. If you do something right, there are rewards, and if you do something wrong, oftentimes there are consequences. That's a pretty basic understanding of justice, that it's about right and wrong, and people get what they deserve. In the passage from Deuteronomy that we heard this morning, Moses is old, and he's getting very close to death, and 40 years before, God took Moses into Egypt and used him to lead the people out of Egypt, out of slavery, and they walked around in the wilderness for 40 years. And now, as Moses delivers these words in Deuteronomy 32, they're just getting ready to go into the promised land. And right before this, Moses says to the people, God says to the people through Moses, "I have set before you the way of life and the way of death. Walk in obedience to God, so that you will stay in the way of life." And so now in chapter 32, Moses is composing a song, and this song is about the relationship between God and the Israelite people and what has happened over these last 40 years. In verse 4, Moses says, "God is the rock, his works are perfect, and all his ways are just.
A faithful God who does no wrong, upright and just is he. At different points later in the song, it talks about how the Israelites will disobey God once they get into the promised land, that God will punish them for their sins because he is upright and just. It is this experience of justice and this experience of consequences for their sins that will ultimately lead the people to honor and revere God as God. It's God's love, but they also need to take God seriously. They need to have this reverence and awe for who God is. So the song instructs them that when it looks like their evil is going unpunished, if they've done something and it seems like they're going to get away with it, know that God will still judge those who are wicked. And even when it looks like God has abandoned the people, know that God will rescue and restore them. So if it ever looks like God is unjust, it's only because God hasn't finished yet. God is completely just, so people will get what they deserve. They will get their just rewards. Now, there are two main aspects to God's justice, and really the second way is just a different way of thinking about the first. So number one, God's justice upholds right and wrong. That's kind of what I said at the beginning. God's justice upholds right and wrong. And the second part of God's justice is that he defends the disadvantaged. So God's justice upholds right and wrong, but God's justice also upholds those who are disadvantaged. As we were talking about this morning, getting ready for church, Sarah was talking about the women's Bible study and how in that study it talked about justice being that those who are kind of at the top of society look out and help and are generous to those who are towards the bottom of society. And so it's again about doing what's right and wrong, about helping those who are in need of some help. Over the past number of years, it's become very popular in our culture to say, what is right for you is right for you, and what is right for me is right for me. I'm sure you've all heard this before. And to a point, there is some wisdom in that. God has created all of us to be different. And that means that we're not all going to be on the same path all of the time. We have different abilities. We have different talents that complement each other. If we were all the same, there'd be a lot of things we couldn't do because we were all gifted the same way. There are things that you like, things that you want, are not for me. It's not what I care for. And that's okay in many circumstances for you to like what you like and me to like what I like. But there's also a time when it's right to say this is right and this is wrong, and we know it to be so because that's what the Bible teaches us. What is right, and what is wrong, and it's not a decision for human beings to figure out on our own. Right and wrong are grounded in the character of God. And God reveals to us what is right and wrong in the Bible. So the Bible doesn't speak to every situation in our lives, but it says enough for us to get a pretty good idea of what's right and wrong in most situations. Even Paul tells the Corinthians that some of you are married and some of you are single. One is not right and the other wrong, but serve God however you were called. So there we see that, you know, there's differences in people. There's diversity, and what's right for one is right for them, and what's right for another is right for them. But all of them are called to serve God however God has called them. Paul also says in that letter, if you want to, eat meat that's been sacrificed to idols. But if you're convicted by doing it, then don't eat it. But in all things, show love and grace to each other, and don't become stumbling blocks to one another. In other things, Paul is very clear that some things are right and some things are wrong. He says to them, do not follow Peter and do not follow Paul and do not follow Apollos as your leader, only Christ. Paul tells them in 1 Corinthians, do not associate with a person who claims to follow Christ if they are a drunkard or a swindler or a sexually immoral person. He says, do not have lawsuits between you. And Jesus is clear when he says, do not hold anger toward your brother or sister.
when he says, do not look lustfully at a woman, when he says, do not hate your enemies, but pray for those who persecute you. These are things that the Bible says are right and wrong. These are things that are grounded in the character of God. They're not random lists that Jesus or Paul made up. These are grounded in God. And they come from the justice of God, from right and wrong. Now, the second part of justice is defending the disadvantaged, which, like I said, is just an application of right and wrong. The Bible tells us multiple times that it's right for us to support the widow and the orphan and the immigrant among you. This is one of the most repeated lines in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. Stand up for the widow and the orphan and the immigrant, because those are the people who typically have no one to help them. If you see someone that doesn't have a lot of help around them, those are the people we are especially called to reach out to. Part of this, too, is to give generously to those in need and help them get back on their own two feet. Part of this is to be a voice for the unborn, because millions of babies continue to be aborted every year. And then give the moms and the families of those who have chosen to keep their babies support. And be a person who will listen and offer healing and hope to a mom, even if they did have an abortion. In Christ, our sins of our past do not count against us. We are called to forgive and to help people heal and have hope. So we reach out to those who are disadvantaged. In the Bible, when there is a breach in justice, God uses two main strategies to deal with those people who have done that. God will either use punishment or restoration. And God shows a great deal of patience for people, giving them a chance to repent of their sins and to be restored to God. It is God's greatest desire that we would be restored to Him, that He wouldn't have to punish. Yet if people do not change, God will use the rod, will punish them for a time so that they can see the error of their ways and get their life back on the right path. And then once God has used punishment, we also see that God gives an opportunity for them to be restored. In the Old Testament, once the people got their king and their kingdom, once Moses took them into the promised land and they sinned just like Moses predicted they would, they got their king and their kingdom, and they became very wealthy, and they forgot God. They didn't get their morals from the scriptures anymore. They did what they wanted to do. Amos says, some of them reclined on ivory couches while others had nothing to eat. And God gave them years to repent, years to see what they were doing was wrong and to choose a different path. And when they didn't get on a different path, God punished them by sending an army to destroy some of their cities and to take some of the people into captivity. It was a horribly painful time, but when their time of punishment was over, God saved them. God returned them back to the promised land, gave them back their land, and restored them as their people, as His people. They rebuilt cities. They rebuilt the temple. God gave them restoration after their time of punishment. So even when God does punish, it's meant to bring people back to Him. The hope of restoration is always part of God's justice. Now, God's justice means that we can trust God to take care of us when we have been mistreated as well, especially if we've been treated very, very badly. In a novel by the British mystery writer P.D. James, there's a detective who shares a common way of thinking. This detective says, you know, I don't go for all of the emphasis on sin and suffering and judgment. And this detective says, I don't believe in God, but if I did, I would like Him to be intelligent, cheerful, and amusing. I would guess that some of us have maybe thought that way about God, and certainly we know people that think that way about God. I don't want a God of sin and suffering and judgment. I just want a God who is intelligent, cheerful, and amusing. And one of the people who is a colleague of this detective is a Jewish person in this book. And this Jewish person says to the detective, I doubt that you would find this kind of a God much of a comfort when your people were herded into the gas chambers. You might then prefer a God of vengeance. We might not, I bet most of us do not, like the thought of God's justice and our sin. But a God who does not deal with sin is not much of a God at all. The Bible is full of passages of people saying the wicked prosper while the good suffer, and wondering why God doesn't do something about it. We don't always understand God's methods, but we trust that God does deal with violations of justice. It might not be in this life even, but God punishes the sins of evildoers. Now, we also know that even the worst sinner can receive God's grace, and that punishment that they deserve can be transferred to Jesus Christ, and that his blood can cover each and every sin. But we also know that God deals with the sins, and when we have been sinned against, we can turn that over to God because he is a God of justice. So when someone does sin against you, God sees it. It's not lost to him, and God will deal with that person and their sin. You may not know when it happens or how it happens, but you can trust that God will take care of it. In the last part of Deuteronomy 32, God says, "Have I not kept this in reserve and sealed it in my vaults? It is mine to avenge. I will repay. In due time, their foot will slip. Their day of disaster is near, and their doom rushed upon them." So God is promising that the people of Israel, when these other people come in and do bad things to you, I've got it taken care of. I see it, and I will repay them for what they've done. So if you don't see justice right away in your life when somebody mistreats you, you can know that it is sealed in God's vaults, and it will be revealed when God says the time is right. And Romans 12:19 tells Christians, "Do not take revenge, but leave room for God's wrath." So it is God's job to see that justice is done and not our own. And there are times, I think, when it is a comfort to know that we have a God who administers justice. However, because we have a God of justice, this also means that if you are the one who mistreats someone, or if you speak unkindly about someone else, or if you harm someone in some way, or even if you have some sin that's in secret, that God's justice also applies to you. So don't think that you just got away with it or that God forgot about it. No, if this is the case for you, then you need to bring that sin before the Lord. He already knows about it, but bring it to him, confess it, and ask for forgiveness. Because an unforgiven sin will cling to you. It will affect your mind and your spirit. But a forgiven sin will be covered by the blood of Christ, and you will be set free from it. When we think about God's justice in terms of our salvation, there is a standard of what's right and wrong in our covenant with God. There is good and there is evil. There is sin and there is righteousness. And because we are humans who are created in God's image, we are created good. But because of sin in the world, we are also evil. And so our sin and our sins go against God's justice when we do what is wrong and evil, which we all do. It's not wrong because the world says that it's wrong, but because that's what God says about it. And God's justice then requires that these sins be made right. Even our sins must be made right. So how do we make these things right with God? How do we restore God's justice? I hope you know the answer to that is we can't. We can't do it. We can't live perfectly. We can't make things right that we've done wrong in the past. And even if we could be perfect from this day forward, it would not make up for the sins we've committed. So it seems hopeless. What do? God's justice has been violated. We did it, and we know we did it. And that means that we're destined for hell, to be apart from God for eternity. But instead of requiring justice from us,
God sent the one who could pay the price for all of our sins. And Jesus took God's justice, took the price, took the consequences of our sin on himself. And God's justice says that because of Jesus' death, he took the punishment, so we are right with God. God did not just wipe out our sin, just say it's okay, don't worry about it, and it was gone. Justice is part of his character. So in order to restore us, a death needed to happen. The fair thing was for us to die for our own sins, but instead Jesus died for our sins, taking the punishment, giving us new life and new relationship with God. And so we have abundant life and eternal life because Jesus has satisfied the requirements of God's justice on our behalf. And he did it because of his great love for us. So it's not just justice. God's justice and mercy and grace and love interact to bring us salvation. So we have a God of justice and mercy, a God of both love and wrath, a God of truth and grace. And all of these things are there in the character of God. These are all parts of what make God to be God. And all of these things affect our life each and every day. It really is personal how God is constituted. Because we have to ask ourselves things like, will my sin have immediate consequences? Or will God show patience and give me a chance to repent? Either way, whether I'm forced to deal with sin or if God delays the consequences, it will be for my good and for my growth. We might ask, how long will God show patience to a nation? And when will God allow a nation to fall? How long will God be patient with a person who rejects grace? And when will God finally allow them to choose the path that they want to choose? The answers to these questions have enormous effects, and how God administers justice affects the lives of people all over the world and for all eternity. So what would happen if in these decisions, in these things that God is overseeing, that God is in control of, what would happen if God made a miscalculation or if God made a mistake? It would be disastrous. People all over the world at all times would suffer horribly if God made a mistake in these things. So for that, friends, we have the promise that God is wise. And in the short amount of time left this morning, we cannot give God's wisdom the full treatment that it deserves, so just a small snippet about God's wisdom for today. In Romans chapter 9 through 11, Paul is teaching about God's relationship with the Hebrew people and then how that affects the Gentiles, how it affects you and I who are not Israelite. Paul talks about how God has, for a time, allowed the Jews to be blinded to the true identity of Christ. And God did that so that Gentiles would have the opportunity to respond to God's grace. Paul says that Israel is like an olive tree, and that some of that branches of that tree have been cut off, and that other branches, us Gentiles, have been grafted into the tree. And God can even graft in those branches that have been cut off if they come to belief again. So God is showing patience, showing great patience and mercy in restoring these dead branches, and God is also cutting off the dead and unproductive branches and dealing with lives of individuals and nations in this process. So we trust that God knows when it's time to lop off a branch and when it's time to add in a branch, and we have to trust fully that he knows what he's doing. And so Paul ends this section of Romans with these words that Will read from chapter 11. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, and his paths are beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord and who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay them? Or in other words, God's wisdom of knowing how to direct history and how to direct people and nations is beyond the scope of what we can understand. One excellent point made by Pastor Lord Stille in Alabama is that we experience God's perfect wisdom in a fallen world. All creation groans under the burden of sin, and God works wisely within this fallen world. So yes, bad things happen to good people, and it seems sometimes like bad people prosper here on earth. And it seems like God's justice and God's wisdom are getting out of whack. But we trust that God's wisdom is always at work, even though we don't always understand or like the way that it happens. And we know that God can handle our anger and our frustration when we see things happening this way. It's kind of like giving the greatest chef in the world faulty ingredients and expecting them to come up with the finest of feasts. The greatest cook in the world, giving them bad ingredients to work with. So instead of giving them the prime cuts of meat that they're used to and premium vegetables and spices, imagine that we give Gordon Ramsay a pound of McDonald's hamburger, overgrown zucchini and cucumbers from the garden, and a little bit of table salt. Even somebody, great chef like Gordon Ramsay, what could he do with that? Well, probably more than you and I could do with it. But he's still not going to be able to create something terribly tasty out of McDonald's hamburger, overgrown zucchini and cucumbers, and a little bit of salt. We know that in this world, this is a fallen world with fallen people, God is not working with all prime ingredients. God will still make something great out of this world, but human sin and disobedience limit how much God's wisdom we actually experience. We know that God wisely applies justice. God wisely knows when to punish and when to restore and make things right. And we know that God does so in such a way that life and faith continue to flourish, even with periods of suffering in our life. And God, in his wisdom, balances these things perfectly. He's working with not great ingredients, but he does a wonderful job with what he has. And so in this life, it means that it's not always going to be easy, but I also know there's nobody that I would trust besides God to make these decisions that affect the whole world and have eternal implications. I'm so glad that God is the one deciding when to punish, when to restore, how to use this justice and all of the aspects of his character in our world. Now, after Jesus returns, and everyone who trusts in Christ is gathered together, and sin and death and sadness and evil are abolished forever, God is going to have a perfect set of ingredients to work with. He will have forgiven people who have been made righteous in Christ. He will have upright angels, a perfect environment in heaven. And God's wisdom is going to go to work in this perfect working environment. And can you imagine what it's going to be like to see the depths of God's knowledge and the riches of his wisdom working in that perfect environment? If we can see God's wisdom, and we do see God's wisdom working today in a fallen world, imagine what seeing God's wisdom in a perfect heaven will be like. We will fall down in worship at the wonder of our God. These are the promises that we keep in mind as we seek to love Jesus and serve others during our time here on earth. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all the parts of your character, all the parts of the character of God. Lord, each one affects us. Each one makes a difference in our daily lives, even when we don't think about it and realize it. God, there are times when we wish that we could maybe get rid of a part of your character, and maybe your justice is one of these times. Maybe sometimes we feel like we had a God who was intelligent and charismatic and always positive and making us happy. But Lord, we thank you that even though there are times you are that to us, that you are also a God who takes sin seriously, a God who takes suffering seriously, a God who knows when it's time to use the rod and when it's time to restore. God, we know that you use all of these things to bring people to you, to further your glory, to give people an opportunity to have your abundant life and your eternal life. God, everything that you do grows out of your love for us. Lord, if there are things in our lives that we need to repent of this morning, we pray that you would reveal that to us. God, we pray for the conviction of the Holy Spirit to help us to see where we have gone astray. And Lord, we thank you for your restoration and love, that because of Christ and his death and resurrection, that we can return to you. Lord, I pray for those who have been mistreated. Maybe it was something this week, maybe it's something deep in the past. Lord, I pray for those people, these people. Lord, I pray that you would remind them that you are in control, that you see what happens in their lives, that you haven't forgotten, and that you will make it right. Lord, I also pray that those who have sinned against us, that they would realize the harm in what they've done, that they would see that they are a sinner in need of Christ, and Lord, that they would turn to you to take the punishment from their sin and restore them to life with you. Lord, I pray that you would help us to see those who are in need and to respond appropriately by being generous and helping them, both with our prayers, with our money, and with our actions and support. And God, we thank you that because of your wisdom, we can trust that you will apply all of these things perfectly, that you know exactly what you're doing and why you're doing it, and that we don't have to take it into our own hands, but we can follow your lead and trust that you are good and looking out ultimately for our welfare. Lord, we thank you for this trust. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Turn in your blue books again to number 87, Great is the Lord, and would you stand for this last song and then remain standing for the benediction.
Thank you.
just a reminder of the meeting in the fellowship hall for those who would be interested in becoming members as soon as we're done here. As you go, receive these words from Deuteronomy and Romans. Proclaim the name of the Lord because he is our rock. His works are perfect and all his ways are just. Proclaim the name of the Lord. The depth of his wisdom is unsearchable. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To God be the glory forever. Amen.